All right. Thank you so much, ladies, for joining me today as we talk about taxes and we learn a few things that we can do as entrepreneurs or small business owners that we can lower our taxes. Even if you have somebody do your taxes for you, which is recommended when you own a business, it's okay. It's a good thing. But by attending a class like this, you learn things that you can do to help your tax preparer. Just because they prepare your taxes, it doesn't mean they know your business. And that's not putting anybody down. That's not telling that they don't know what they're doing. Yes, they do know, but they know what their field is, which is taxes, not necessarily your business. So the purpose of this class is to teach the business owners things that they can do to keep better track of their expenses, to understand how their deductions work. So that way they can actually maximize their deductions and pay the minimum that they have to pay in taxes. And why I'm talking about this? Well, I'm going to share a little bit about myself. So my name is Sorana Blackfoot. I'm originally from Romania and I moved to the US in 2002. That's a little over 20 years ago. Growing up in a different country, I learned the money system there. So I knew how money works, how you got paid. I had a mom that actually paid out salaries for a big factory. So I was very much aware of money my whole life. I always loved saving, especially really nice, crisp new bills. I had a tendency to hold on to those just a little longer than the raggedy looking ones. So I grew up very much aware of cash. However, I had no idea what a credit history is, how a credit card really works, or how you handle a mortgage here compared to the way I was raised. So I had to learn all of that after I moved here. And back then, I believed that everybody else already knew all of this stuff. And I just didn't know it because I had moved here, but people that lived here their whole life, for sure, they must know this, right? Well, as I was sharing with people stuff that I was learning, the feedback I would get was, wow, I didn't know that. Oh, nobody told me that. And from there, I developed my mission to educate people how money really works and how you can make more money, how you can keep more of the money that you make. And why I do that mostly for women through my company, Unbroke Women, is because I believe that we change the community. When the man provides for the family, it's all nice and good. But when we know how money works, we can have our family do better. And we can also make a bigger impact in the world because we have a tendency to help the community more, to get more involved, and to also share what we know with other people more so than men do. And that's not a bad thing on men. It's just how we are created, how our minds work and how our hearts work. So my main focus is teaching women how to have better relationships with their money. And I've been self-employed since 2005. So I've had to figure out things around taxes. I've had people do my taxes for a number of years. And back in 2011, I decided that I actually wanted to learn how taxes really operate. What can I do? How can I maximize my deductions? How can I lower my taxes? And I decided to become a tax preparer, which I did. Last year, adding to that and building on that, I became an enrolled agent. That's a designation in the tax world. And if it doesn't sound familiar to you, it's okay. An enrolled agent has the right to deal directly with the IRS on behalf of a person and represent them, even if they don't do their taxes. Anybody that does your taxes can talk to the IRS on your behalf if you give them that power, but just because they do your taxes, an enrolled agent can represent you without doing your taxes. And the reason why I went that route is because I wanted to make sure that I know what's going on in my own taxes. And then, of course, I learned how to do other people's taxes. So today, we're going to talk taxes. And I promise I won't make tax preparers out of you, ladies. So don't get too scared. Please make sure you ask any questions that you have. because I'm here to answer them and no question is off the table. So don't feel embarrassed. Don't feel ashamed. We're all here to learn, okay?
Oh, so right.
Yes, go ahead.
You said that role was, it's called a role, like R-O-L-E?
Enrolled. E-N-R-O-L-L-E-D. Enrolled.
Oh, okay.
Enrolled agent.
Mm-hmm. Enrolled agent. Okay.
EA for short. Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome. All right. So one of the concepts that I teach through my business is financial serenity. What does that mean? Well, it's a little bit more than financial freedom. And I know that most people are familiar with the term financial freedom. You can do what you want, when you want, and it's okay. You can afford it. And that's all great. To me, financial serenity is more than that, because it's not just that you do what you want, when you want, and you can afford it, but it's also that you feel fulfilled. You enjoy yourself while you do all of that. And I believe that the way things are nowadays and the way most people live their life and live the things that happen in their lives, a lot of us lose that fulfillment piece. A lot of us focus on the next achievement, but maybe we don't really focus on feeling that fulfillment when we achieve it. So here's the recipe to financial serenity. You create, you preserve, and you transfer your wealth. So I'm here to teach you how to preserve now by lowering your taxes. Okay, here's one of my favorite quotes. It's a Chinese proverb, and it says, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The next best time is now. So if you feel that, oh, it's too late, I should have done this before, it's okay. Now it's your time. Never feel that it's too late, okay? Let's talk about money mindset before we roll into tax talk. So what is money mindset? Money mindset is, how do you feel about money? What is your relationship with money? And here are a few questions that I like to call food for thought. So if you can take a piece of paper, answer these questions, or take a screenshot, answer them later, but make sure you go over this and see how you feel about all of this. Question number one is, how does my money feel about me? Money is energy, so it will be attracted or it will be repulsed by certain things that we do. And we may not believe that. Ultimately, money is a piece of paper or money is numbers on the computer screen, but money does have feelings. It's energy. So just like a magnet, it gets attracted or not by something. So how do you make money feel? How do you behave with your money, right? How do you treat your cash? Question number two, how can I make more money? Whether that means starting a business, and congratulations to the both of you. I know before we started the class, you both shared that you're starting new ventures. So that's always a great thing as far as I'm concerned. So that's one way to make money. If you talk to any of the financial gurus, they'll explain to you about having multiple streams of income. That means having money come to you from multiple sources. That's always a good idea. Some of those can be passive, such as having investments that are producing for you. And some of those can be active, like different businesses. Okay. How can I keep more of the money I make? Okay, so this is where we're touching on tax talk. So it's not just about making more money. It's also about knowing what happens with the money once you get it. Do you get a dollar, spend a dollar? Do you get a dollar, have to pay a dollar somewhere, like in taxes or in something for your business? Or do you get to keep that dollar or put that dollar on the side or invest it into growing your business. A lot of people don't like the word budget, right? We all get a little bit uncomfortable. We don't really want to deal with that. So if you're one of those people, then don't worry about keeping track of every penny you spend, because it's not going to be sustainable. So even if you start doing it, you're not going to be able to maintain it forever. But one thing you can do is keep track of where your money is going for a month, and then you'll know what your patterns are. Okay. Question number four, how can I make sure my family is taken care of in my absence? And here's where you're looking to make sure that you have protection in place. Things like insurance, retirement set up, so that way whenever you retire, you can live off of that growth. And if something happens to you, your family gets that, okay? And also in life insurance, now there are policies that have living benefits, which pay when you cannot work for a medical reason or an injury that makes you disabled. So those are ways to protect the family, to make sure that your income is replaced if anything happens to you, okay? And question number five, last but not least, how do I know I have the best? So if you have all of this taken care of, fabulous, you're one of the few, because most people don't. But maybe in the back of your mind is this little nagging voice saying, how do I know I have everything I need? How do I know I have what I should have? How do I know what I have is the best thing and not just something that was sold to me? Well, the best way to find that out is to have an audit or a discovery call or a session with somebody that has no vested interest in selling you something or in talking to you about your things as being the best when they're not. So that's somebody that can take a look at everything and can tell you, you do have the best, or here's a better alternative. And there are lots of financial professionals out there that can do that. That is one of the services I offer as well. And just get one, maybe two, maybe even three opinions just to make sure, right? Treat your money like you treat your body. When you go to the doctor to make sure everything's okay with you, then you find something out, you probably want a second opinion, right? So treat your money the same way. Get a second opinion, make sure everything is okay. All right, let's get into some tax talk. Most people feel that tax talk is intimidating. It's an uncomfortable subject. We don't really want to talk about it. It's a necessary evil. We deal with it every April. But when you don't talk about it before time, then you can't plan it. And when April rolls around, you just pay whatever the government says you have to pay because you haven't prepared, you haven't made plans to pay less. It's a great idea to have a tax preparer. That tax preparer can just be a tax preparer, no credentials necessary, or they could be an accountant, a CPA, or an EA. Depending on what the certifications are, that shows their level of knowledge and also their level of help that they can provide. For instance, accountants and CPAs can also a lot of times offer services of bookkeeping. So as your companies grow, you may want to look for one of those. An EA most likely will not do bookkeeping. Some of us have other bookkeepers that we work with and we can contract that work out, but usually that's not a service that we provide personally. But what we can do is review everything and make sure that we plan for your next tax season together. And we also make sure that if anything is amiss and you get that dreaded letter from the IRS saying that they want to take a closer look at something in your tax return, we can represent you and talk to the IRS on your behalf. The worst idea about taxes is to postpone everything until April. A lot of us are not comfortable with it. right? So what's the best way to deal with something when we don't want to deal with it, when we are intimidated by it, or we feel stressed about it? Well, we just don't, right? We just say, not now, I'll do it tomorrow, I'll do it next week, next month, and then comes April and we don't have a choice. Well, some of us don't even want to deal with it in April and we file an extension and then we have until October. And what that usually does is postpones the whole thing until October and we still don't do anything for the next 6 months. And now October becomes stressful. Some entrepreneurs out there use the shoebox method. What that means is that they take a box and dump all of their receipts in it. I have a bookkeeper friend that likes entrepreneurs with shoeboxes because she goes in there and digs through everything and sorts everything and then sets up a system for them. If that's you, then we can talk and I would be glad to make an introduction. If that's not you, congratulations. You are one of the few that doesn't use the shoebox method. I will tell you that it's not a very reliable way to keep track of your taxes. It's not a good accounting method, okay? And most people, when it comes to taxes, all they really do is just hope to get a refund. Now, there's a good thing and a bad thing about the refund. It's great you get a big chunk of money in April or May, whenever, or sometimes earlier than that, whenever you file. But the bad thing is you just gave the government a whole lot of money and now they're just giving you the money back with no interest. So you would have been better off having that money invested somewhere and producing some more money for you. All right. Now, if you sit down with the pro, here are a few questions that you can ask them. Oh, and I just figured out that I forgot to tell you, ladies, as I go over everything, if you have any questions, please feel free to interrupt and ask your questions, okay? You can hold them till the end, that's fine. I will have some Q&A time at the end, but if you have any question that pops to mind as I go through everything, feel free to ask. All right, so if you sit down with the tax pro, here are a few things that you want to ask. If they are just a tax preparer, a tax expert, and they don't really do any accounting outside of that, you can ask them how many tax seasons they've been working. Now, I understand everybody starts somewhere and there's nothing wrong with that. But if you get somebody that's new in the tax business, make sure they have a supervisor that they can ask questions of. Make sure that somebody with experience can take a look at your tax return to ensure that everything is correct. Okay. A second question that is very important is, do they know your industry or the type of business that you have? When you're doing nonprofit, do they know the nonprofit side of things? Do they know anything about personal taxes for the people that start nonprofits and how that may or may not impact your personal taxes, depending on whether or not you're getting paid from the nonprofit. Right. So make sure that you ask those questions. And one thing you can ask to also learn something from them is maybe ask for an example of a deduction that a lot of entrepreneurs overlook, or that they mistakenly take, or something that maybe they think is deductible, but it's not. So that's a good learning point for you when you sit down with somebody. And also it shows you that they do understand the business and it shows you that they care about their clients because they want to make sure their clients understand what's going on and not just show up and just get your taxes done, have a nice life, see you next year. If you sit down with an accountant or a CPA, this may possibly be the person that also does your accounting. So you will see them throughout the year. So that way they can take a look at your books. They can make sure everything balances and everything is on track and all the reports are submitted throughout the year that you need to submit. So you need to make sure that they can meet with you before the end of the tax year so you can plan and you can figure out ways to reduce your taxes. A lot of companies make some big purchases towards the end of the year, because that way that becomes a tax deduction. And when they have a profitable year, it helps them lower taxes for that year. So that's why it's really good around this time of year to sit down with your accountant or your CPA. And Cheryl, you were talking about a transport business. So if you own a truck and you do very well, maybe a year, 2 years, 3 years into the business, you buy another truck. And towards the end of the year would be a good time to ask and make sure that you can do that and that it will help you lower your taxes for that year and even for the following years, because you would have to amortize that. All right. Another question that is very good to ask your CPA is if they would be willing to meet with you and with your investment advisor. Your investment advisor will tell you how to put money aside so you can retire and how to build that portfolio or how to plan your exit strategy from your business. But your CPA or accountant has great input there. So you need both of them to be in the same room. You need both of them to communicate. So make sure you don't miss out on that. And the learning point here from the accountant or the CPA can be, what apps or what programs do you recommend for tracking the expenses? They use their own most of the time, which is great. But sometimes you can have some things that you can use in order to support what they're doing. So when you keep track of things, you can make their job a lot easier and you can make the process a lot smoother, because now you can give them all of that information. And here are a few of my personal favorites and things that I know of for tracking and for keeping all of your tax information together. It's always a good idea to have a mile tracker. Here are a few that I know of. I personally use TripLog and I'm very used to it, so I like it. It does a great job for me. Mile IQ is another a good one, and Hurdler is something that just came up for me recently, so I don't know a whole lot about it. None of these are really free, but none of them are super expensive. So it's definitely worth the investment. Why it's important to have a mile tracker? Well, because you need to know if you have a vehicle that you use for both business and personal reasons, how much of that is for business and how much of that is for personal. And the IRS some years ago, quite a few years ago, started accepting electronic logs. So these work just fine. These keep track okay of everything, but you need to make sure you have some sort of tracking system. If you just say, well, I drove 1,000 miles or I drove 10,000 miles this year for business, it's not usually a good idea because you may not be able to prove that. Furthermore, a round number is not likely to happen. Right? If you drive 10,000 miles, it's not likely that it's 10,000 even. It could be 9,932, or it could be 10,029, but that's still not 10,000. So you are better off keeping track of all that and being able to submit the correct information when you do your tax. All right, for accounting and bookkeeping, if you do it in-house or if you have somebody do it for you and maybe you have some of the information that you input, QuickBooks is a great idea. They have online version, they have desktop version, and it can be as simple as for a solopreneur. So when you are working by yourself, and it can be as sophisticated as a whole enterprise with a bunch of employees. So it has different levels. It's a good one to check out. For taxes, there's TurboTax that you can file with, of course, Tax Act, and there are a lot of other in-person like Jackson Hewitt, H&R Block and so forth, where you can go and file, get your taxes filed for you if you wanna do it yourself. I prefer TurboTax because I know the software best, but there are other ones that you can use. And TaxCaster is an app or a website that TurboTax has where you can estimate what your taxes will be. So it's a great tool to use for planning taxes, so you know what to expect. And for everything that you take a deduction on, it's a good idea to have a receipt scanner or a scanning app on your phone that you can use, and you keep all of the scanned receipts. IRS some years ago said that it's not enough to show the bank statement. If on your bank statement, for instance, it shows that you went to Lowe's, that doesn't mean that you went to Lowe's for business if you have a contracting business. So it's good to show the receipt, and then you can show, okay, I went there because I bought A, B, and C, and I did this. In my business, I do events, and some of them are online like this, like classes where I teach. And of course, this doesn't cost me as far as food, but if I do an in-person event like what we did last night, that was in person, and we offered some snacks and we offered a little bit of wine for the ladies there to taste. So because of that, I would go to a grocery store to buy some of the things, or I would pay a caterer, or I would go to, let's say, Panera and buy some takeout. Well, if I don't keep the receipt, and all I say is I went to the grocery store or I went to Panera, that doesn't show what I bought. So the IRS has no way of knowing that it's for my business. And if I want that deduction, I need to be able to prove it. Okay. Any questions so far, ladies?
No, ma'am, not for me.
Okay. I hope that this gave you some understanding of what you can do as an entrepreneur. And here are 7 tips for the entrepreneurs. So this is not what your accountant does. This is what you can do to support your accountant. All right. And to also be, of course, all above board with everything that you may need down the road. All right. So anything tax related, make sure you keep for 3 years. Beyond 3 years, the IRS doesn't really have the right to ask for it unless they can prove that there's a suspicion of fraud. If there's a suspicion of fraud, they can ask for it 50 years from now. But if they just think, well, there's this mistake, or we want more proof of this, they cannot ask for it after 3 years. So make sure you keep everything for 3 years. Credit card statements are not enough. So keep your receipts. Approximate or about is not good enough. You can't say, well, I spent about $5,000 to set up my business. Chances of you spending $5,000 even are quite slim. And I'm not saying you can't spend $5,000, but it's not going to be $5,000 even. It could be $4,959. Or it could be 5,237. So you need to have the exact amount. You cannot say about 5,000. And you cannot say I drove about 1,000 miles or about 10,000 miles. You still need to give the exact numbers. So keeping track is always a good idea. Have protection in place for yourself and for your key employees. When you have a business that grows because some people that you hired are performing outstandingly, you need to make sure you have protection over them, which means life insurance. So if something happens to them, you can hire somebody that can take over, or you can give them money so they can stay at home and recuperate faster, right? Make sure you don't endanger your business by not having protection in place, by not having life insurance on yourself and on your key employees. Now, saving for retirement is important. I know when you start a business, you're always thinking of where's my next client going to be? Where's my next sale coming from? And that's a very legitimate thing to do. But you also need to plan your exit strategy. right? You need to make sure that if you want your business to go to a child or another family member, you tell them that and you work that into the growth of your business so they can take over. If you want to sell your business, then make sure it's structured in such a way as to be sellable. But with all of that going on, never neglect saving money for your retirement. I know you ladies had different careers already and are close to retirement or looking to possibly retire. So then make sure that your business is also a source of income in retirement. And once you decide to stop that business or exit that business, that it helps. So as I was saying, have an exit strategy. I know that's a lot to think of when you start a business because you're thinking about how you're setting it up. But when you have the end in mind, it will make the setup a lot easier and it's going to make a lot more sense. Plus, it will save you a whole lot of headache later on when you're trying to pivot. And if all of this sounds intimidating, if all of this sounds scary, if all of this sounds like, oh my God, this is too much, I'm already doing a gazillion other things, don't worry. There are people that specialize in all of these different areas. Just talk to a pro. In fact, talk to multiple pros. Talk to one for each area or talk to two or three for each area. It's always a good idea to get input from people that are in that field. And I like that, Linda, I believe it was you that said, you know your strengths and doing the paperwork for the nonprofit is not one of them. So it's good that you recognize that, approach a pro that can help you with what you need help with.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, thank you.
You are very welcome. So this is what I had to share. And if you want a little bit more information about starting a business, there are a few books in a series from business or women business conference that I organize annually. And Get It Done, Get It Designed, Get It Developed, Get It Discovered, Get It Delivered. All of those books are written by the speakers from the different years of the conference. And they're all about different aspects of the business. They apply to any business in any field. It's not industry specific. And if you want to know more about my story and how I came to learn a bunch about money, my personal book, my money story is New World, New Dreams. And in it, I talk about what I learned about money growing up and the things that I had to learn about money once I moved over into the US. If you would like to keep in touch, if you'd like to know what I have going on or what else I know that I share, I have a free Facebook group. It's called Unbroke Women. And the Facebook link is at the bottom. Feel free to join us. It is women only. But I share things about business there and also things about money. I would love to have you ladies come in there and meet some awesome ladies and also learn a little bit that you can use in your own businesses. And I'm ready for your questions.
Well, I'd like to first say thank you. This was pretty informative and unfortunately, I got distracted, so I need to go back and look at some of the slides to come up with my questions. But overall, I thought it was a really good presentation. Thank you.
You are very welcome. Well, you will have my contact information. Like I said, you can join the Facebook group. That'll be great. And you can reach out with any questions that you have. Also, feel free to connect with me on social media. My name is Sorana Blackfoot. I promise you there's nobody else with that name. So if you search me, you will find me. Feel free to reach out and ask anything once you are watching the recording. I will have the recording on YouTube in the next couple of days, most likely. So I will send you the link for it.
Okay. Thank you.
You're very welcome. My pleasure.
Thank you, Sorana.
You're very welcome, Cheryl. Do you have any questions?
No, ma'am. It takes me a minute, like, to digest some of this stuff.
Okay.
So It was very good, very enlightening. I appreciate you taking your time out to educate us about this stuff, because, yeah, these taxes ain't no joke.
Right.
That's true. That's true. Mm-hmm. They scare a lot of people.
Yeah. It's not scary, but it's just knowing who to go to. Like, you know, I've had participated in some other classes, and I just don't remember them saying, you know, specifically who to go to for this or who to go to for that. So you helped straighten that out for me, and I appreciate that.
My pleasure. Just like I said to Linda, if you want to join my Facebook group, I would love to see you in there. You can reach out to me. Feel free to find me on social media. Reach out with any questions that you have, even if they come up next week or 2 months from now. Feel free to ask any questions that you come across. And I'll be glad to help you if you need any connections with people in different areas of the business. Let me know. Mm-hmm. I do have a lot of connections, so I can help connect you with people that will be able to get your business going and cover whatever areas that may not be your strength.
Okay, I appreciate that.
You are very welcome. Thank you, ladies, for joining me today. I'm glad I was able to give you information. I hope I didn't overwhelm you. So take your time and listen to it again, because it's always a good idea to listen to something that you never heard before a couple of times, and you will for sure hear things that you didn't hear.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Well, thank you, ladies. I do have to go. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Right. Okay. Right. Take care, everyone.
You too. Bye.
Bye-bye.